because we grow up starting with a strap or a large center grip shield. If we do this, we punch out and block. This is really stupid with real time. But I'm gonna show you why. Very slowly. If I'm not perfect, that's gonna go right through and hit me anyway. And remember, if we're doing unarmed combat, light shots are not a super thing. I mean, they're not lightsabers. But we do want to know that if he's swinging a 3-foot razor blade at me, even if I take most of the damage off, he hits me and slides through, that's a bad day for me. So, and hands are very, very vulnerable. So I don't even necessarily want to do this, because I might need one fingers and my damage over. So when we defend, or when we attack, we essentially want to end up like this. Boom. See how my sword has come to the thumb of my buckler? And that is, in fact, how he tells you to start the first play. So he assumes you're in an open ward out of distance. I do not get seared. I do this. Because, again, that's really hard. So I have to be in a space where I need to step. And then when I'm going to make contact, my sword is going to clear. That's super important. So we're going to get into that a little bit.
Sorry,
I'm
distracted.
That's okay.
I'm just jealous. He said, if I do that, I get in trouble.
So if you look at your handout, you don't have to look at this. If you refer to your handout later, which I'm sure all of you will, one of the notes I make is that this is not a shield, this is a paired defense. So what I mean by that is we want to defend with paired tools, then they can split apart once we have control and do bad things to the other guy. But we don't want to try and stay here and punch out from home base. That's not really what we want to do. So the major tactical idea, thought process in the KDF, the German sword fighting, is the idea of initiative. We have what is called bore and knock, the before and the after. So essentially, you want to have the initiative in a fight all the time. You want your opponent to agree that you are the boss of this game. And if they disagree, you want to take it. And if they're trying to convince you that they're the boss of the engagement, you either want to take it away from them or leave and come back. So you always want to think about, you always want to be in the before. You always have the initiative. That doesn't always mean you have to swing. One of the plays we see is that if Connor is there in a guard, I might actually do something where I do this to provoke him to attack. And I'm going to do that, right? So I move first to get him to do something. So he thinks he's in the board. He thinks he has the initiative. But really, I got him to do what I want. So the way I like to describe it is, if you are doing the thing that you wanted, you are probably in the board. If you are reacting in an unplanned manner, you are probably in the knock, and the Germans say this is a very bad thing. And if you're reacting in a sword fight, you're probably in the board. So that is really key, is that control is paramount. You don't give up position to try to land a shot. Because if the other person spazzes out and you miss, then you don't want to do that. So that tactical concept is very, very important, the initiative in a fight. This is different than Italian manuals might talk more about the time, right? We talked about this in different tempos. Germans don't really think about it that way. They get to the same place. But mentally, the way they have the picture of the fight is a little different. They talk about the initiative before that. Does that make sense? We didn't have whole class just before. So another thing that is incredibly important in this very emphasized in German school is binding and wipe. It is center line control. So if Connor comes out, go to long place. So if he's here, especially with this place, when I push against his flat, he's weak. Sword's locked on the flat, and right, and he doesn't have the leverage. If he turns his edge in, now I'm pushing against the more rigid part of the sword, and he has leverage advantage. So we always want to wind our edge into the opponent's sword so we have mechanical advantage, and we want to control the center line. If I attack Connor like this, even if I hit him, do you see how I have no control of the center line? This is bad. I'm going to die. Right? So what I want to do is I want to attack in a way that controls the center line as I commit. So in that way, the attacks both offend him and defend him. It's really, really important. Now, if you have an educated opponent, they're going to try and do the same thing to you. So you sometimes end up in something that looks like this. Boom, up. We're kind of fighting over the center line. This is the bottom, right? So we have the concept of winding. There is inner winding. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to essentially roll the edge of my hand this way. And I'm going to do that in a way that gets me a mechanical and a leverage. Right? So I'm winding in towards the sword. And that keeps me covered and puts my point online. Now if he pushes out very hard, that inner line's not going to work. So I'm going to do an outer line. winding in towards the sword, and we have winding out away from the sword. Winding out should only happen as a reaction. And that reason for this is, he's in long point, and I wind in, even if I miss him, right, like, I'm protected. If he's in long point, and I wind out, I actually have no control over the sword. So the only reason you wind out is if they push way over, right? So essentially, you wind out if you have the initiative. Because if I attack him and he goes, oh god, defend. And then I can wind in here. He's not attacking now. He's just reacting to what I'm doing. So it's safe to do another one. If he does something else, I'm not going to wind out. Because if I lose control of the sword, again with the death and the stabbing. So what's going to be important, and we can spend just a minute to talk about this. Winding is not pushing. It's very important. I am not going to take my hand and shove. What winding is rotating. So, with your sword, without this ring, I think about roll up to one side, roll out to the other side. So, it's a rolling motion, a turning motion, it is not a shoving motion. It's very, very important. Just like the snatch back we were talking about, right? It's the rolling. So, the nice thing is that means you can create a lot of force, a little bit of rolling, without having to pull the sword away back or push the sword away over and exposing all those lines. So, that's very important. You wind in, or you wind out.
A good practice on this, just a question, is your point. Do you want to keep it in like this, almost the same area?
When you're practicing, there's different ways to do it. Winding is the motion, the way you apply it is different. So for example, if we're here, just five, and I want to stab you, I'm going to wind in here, and I'm going to hit. If we're here and I want to hit you, I might wind out, and see how my point comes around, and that's where we play the other buckling. So it's the same winding motion, but now I'm letting my point travel so that it becomes a strike instead of a hit. So that's why I'm emphasizing the motion and not, when I practice keeping the points online, because that's always safe. There are times. So the important thing is the motion. So when I start having you guys go through the plays, try very hard not to push over with your palm, try very hard to wind this way. Like I said, again, any of these concepts we could spend a whole class on, but we're short on time, so just kind of an overview. Really, my hope is that you get hooked and you go look at the manuals and you do this forever. Wind in is towards the sword. That's what you want to know. Because if your sword's over here, now I'm going to wind in either way. So it's about towards the sword or away. So for example, if I do this and you were to wind that, that's now winding out. So now you can wind that way, and now it's winding in.
So it's like oriented on your opponent's
record. Yeah, you wind in towards your sword, or you wind out away. What's your question?
It's not the same question. It's like so it all depends on your opponent's weapon.
Cool. All right, so we talked about winding. We talked about controlling the center line. Another important concept that we heavies are particularly guilty of is the idea of attacking from outside. So, Jeff, would you be here, please? So I do not want to come to range and then start to fight. This is, especially with weapons, right? This is a fast reflex game. If I guess wrong or I'm unlucky, I'm gonna die. That's not good. What I want is to be in a place, especially if I'm using an open ward, which is what these back things are. I want to be in a place where within steps, I can hit. Because that gives me time. If he does something I don't like, be like, oh my god, no, I don't like that at all. Right? So we, and there's the same thing with thrust. If I'm in Auburn and I want to come over to thrust, I'm not gonna walk up to here and then try to stab. I want to come in with a step or a one so that I have control and time to make the cool stuff happen. The other thing is if I want to do a feint, for example, right? Feints are awesome. I use them all the time. However, if I march in here and go, huh, whack, it's not going to work, right? As soon as I'm doing my little feint, he's going to smash me in the head. So, and it's the same thing with the snap down. So if you look, there's one technique I use a lot. So I'm going to have a high lead edge. Okay. I'm going to lunge at. Because if he does something I don't like, I can leave. I'm not going to come in here and do this, because I'm going to do my head with that. So I'm essentially going to attack high. If he takes it, then I can finish my movement, and I put the bucklers on, and we'll talk about the concept. So the idea of attacking from outside to your opponent, and being in your finished position when you land. So don't go step, hit, because you see the first thing he saw of me was my face. Step, hit, not good. We want step, hit. That's very, very important.
When you're coming together with your offense, when you're coming here, I've seen you come together, you know, top to bottom and here. Is this more correct to cover the hand?
With this, without a basket, this is more correct. With the basket, it doesn't fit as well, and I can move the hand from the line. So it depends what combat sport you're doing. If I had a real sword, you better believe I'm doing this so I don't get my thumb ripped off by another real sword.
Right. So technically, the amendment, this is correct.
This, point in front. Because again, if my pullions are not in front of my hand, I'm really gonna snap. So the pullions being in front of the hand are very important. Because this, my hands are fairly safe. This, my hands are gonna get smashed all day. So,
sorry to be
there. No, that's a good question. So really quickly, I'm going to show you three steps. I'm gonna need a lot of overview, and I'm gonna show you the plays, and we're gonna do the plays, and we'll be great. I just wanna tickle your brain a little bit. So the three basic steps, and let's just have everybody take whatever stance you like to fight, it doesn't really matter. We have a gather step or a shuffle step.
Boom, boom.
Easy enough, right? What we don't want to do is collect and step back. Because if we collect, we're going to get knocked down our flag. So we want to step out and recover. Step back and recover. So you're essentially going stance to stance. That is a gather or shuffle step. You can just do the shuffle step shuffle, right? Good. If you can, land on the ball that you can. Shuffle step, gather step. The other kind of step is a passing step, which is exactly like it sounds. One leg passes from the other. We're walking. Boom. Boom. We still want to land on the balls of our feet, and we still want to go stance to stance. Anytime I stop, I should be stable. If I'm fighting and I end up here and I'm trying to do something, if it doesn't work, I'm in a lot of trouble. So always take two small steps over one big one if you need to. We have gather steps. The last step is what we call an offline step. Sometimes you hear the word reverse, sometimes you hear triangle step, you hear all kinds of stuff. Essentially what we're going to do is we're going to step out and pivot the back foot away. So, don't want to cross step, that's very important. So my back leg is going to step out away, and then what am I finally doing? Pivot around. There you go. And then we just reverse motion. We step out and pivot back. So again, we could do this forever. Boom. This is going to be fun.
I think it's the first time I've ever almost done that right.
Okay. This offline step is going to be important because we're going to do some low-line attacks covering with the buckler. And it's great to cover stuff with the buckler. The buckler is not large. If you can cover and get your face out of the way, this is better. So we're going to try and do both. Does that make sense? All right. Now that was a lot of groundwork before we even got into the play. Does anybody have questions or clarifications on the really basics I gave you before we get into the actual technique?
Yes. Last
okay.
Step out.
So I'm in my stance, right? What I want to do is I want to go that way. So I'm going to step my back foot out. I'm going to essentially be a human gate. This leg is my gate. I'm going to. And if I reverse it, this foot is not going to go out. Now this is my gate. So you're just essentially reversing the motion. Try hard not to let yourself get here. Especially if you have a good. And try to pivot on the ball. All right. Talk about some plays. So these are the six techniques that Linus will teach us inside the mirror. The techniques are important. The concepts are more important. Trying to teach and reinforce concepts with techniques. So, we'll talk about what the concepts are. So the first one, we get to just attack. We have the initiative, he's willing to give me the move. So all I'm gonna try and do is clunk him in the head, right? And he's gonna parry. So, he ends up in long point, doesn't really matter what guard he's in. I am out of range, can't just pop me in the nose, that's good. So I'm gonna be in my high ward, and I'm gonna step forward, I'm gonna try and clunk him in the head. He parried, okay? But I attack first, and I close the line. So if I didn't do that, I'm going to take it in the face, not good. So make sure. Now, if he's weak, I'm just going to stab him in the face. See how because his center line is not super well covered, I can just reach forward and stab him in the face? So short sword fights are good sword fights. So if you can, just hit him in the head. Oh, he blocked it. Cool, stab him in the face. If you can, just do that. If he's pushed over well, we're going to do that line. And just snap him. That's the whole thing. That's the whole first play. So, okay. Hand goes towards the thumb of the buckler. In fact, Linus says, put your sword towards the thumb of the buckler. This is just to make sure your stuff slides down and doesn't hurt.
So is he also specifying some passing stuff to get in? So it could be a...
It could be a gather step. I could just as easily take this from a low guard or from here and gather it. Yeah. The point is that my hand is here, I'm covering the high line. Then I wind, put it out to the hip. So, and in fact, when I fight heavy, I often use this guard and I do the gather step. This is useful. Boom. Wind. Step. This also stacks my body behind my tools again. This is really important. I could do this without moving, but the chances of him hitting me are a little higher. So what I want to do is just kill him, or just stab him, or I'm going to wind and step around so that I'm once again stacked behind my tools. That's the first one. Second play is a little less optimal because he attacks me, so he has the board. There's a bunch of ways I could end up here. So the first play is an overcut. The second play is an undercut. A bunch of ways you could get there. I'll just start from over. So he's going to cut at me. My long edge. So I'm doing a rising cut motion. And then the manual says you wind, so you have two shields on the left. So I have a pair of tools. And then I'm going to do this. Right? So I'm going to snap it. Bam, right in the face. But I need my buckler to come with me, because if I just do this, something bad might happen. So I've got my pair of tools. If he raises his tools to block that, I'm going to keep my buckler high, and I'm going to come down, whack him in the leg, and leave. Very important. Because let's say he's immortal, he's got crazy amounts of adrenaline. If I'm a heavy, my body mechanics tell me my shot didn't land. So I've done this, he's alive. I do this, but I didn't leave. There's a good chance he's going to cut around the line. So we want to cover the most common, oh shit, panic shot, and we want to get out of that. That makes sense? Questions so far?
Yeah.
Alright, so that's the second play. So the first play is overcut, stab him, spin him. Second play is undercut, hit him, third play is actually kind of fun. Third play is a deflection. So there's a bunch of ways we could have gotten it. So did you beat a high guard? So I could have thrown a shot, he backed out, and now I've airballed. Oh shit. I could have actually decided to transition in regard to bait him into a shot. I could do that. All kinds of stuff I could do. I could also just actually be in what's called changing guard, which is not a primary guard, and just gone and try to get him cut. Whatever works, right? So we're here. So if he's going to cut at my head, I'm going to do a rising deflection. Boom. And cut to his head. Right. And again, I'm doing this outside step. Very important. Because I don't want to stay here. If I do this, maybe I'll get it right. Maybe I'll get it in the face. So if I can, boom, and cut him in the head. If he parries that, I'm going to do that outside wind. And look where that puts my point. Now, why can I do an outside wind? Because I regained the initiative. He's now acting defensively. So I'm going to keep the pressure, and it's safe for me to do this outside wind. He's not going to want to get stabbed in the face. So if he blocks, I can put the tool high and cut low. So it's just a different way of getting to that high-low trend. So again, same thing. Boom. Pop. Outside wind. Stab him in the face. He doesn't like that. I told him. We're going to do more. Number four, we get initiative. Yay. Number four, I'm going to go onside, offside, high cut. Onside, offside, high cut. I want this. Technically, it's a growing stab. Be nice if that partner. And then I'm going to show you number five. I'm not going to show you number six. Well, I'll show you in a second. I love number five. And check this out. There's a wrap involved. It's called a plunge cut. So the way it looks like this. What I'm going to do is I'm going to throw a wrap. First, I'm going to start my motion because it's an overthrust. And I'm just going to stab him. If I see he's going to block it, I just engage and come in on the other side. Okay. But look, I got a good guard. If he is not dead, right? I want cover. So I'm going to start my wrap from outside, disengage from here. This actually works really well. Okay. If you parry it though, so I've done this, I've done my disengage. Again, I go for the outside wind because again, I have the initiative. It's crazy, right? Super fun. Alright, and then the last one, just for Genzy. He attacks me. Half sword. Grab his buckler, rip it off his hand, smash him in the face. We're not going to practice that one today. That's not legal in any of our combat sports. But remember, these things need to be sharp enough to cut skin and speed the sword. They don't need to be razor sharp. Jab it, as long as it's not traveling in your hand, you're okay. So your jab it, half sword, with the weapon out of hand, smash it. Maybe you pull it off and bite it, maybe you could. It's cool, it's a good way to round out the system. So, what all these.
We don't do that. Yeah. This is manual stuff. Next Cornet, I see somebody grab the sword. Hey! Damn it, Mark.
What's fun is that we were practicing this with Fred, when Fred has a strapped heater, and we did this, he's like, haha, I can't take it out. And I grabbed the bottom, and I turned it and put him in an arm bar. Don't do that one either. All right. So let's talk about the first play. We're going to get through as many as we can. So the first play, if you are a HEMA person, you can do it exactly as written. You're going to be in the outside ward, you're going to attack, boom. Okay. If they're weak, you stab them in the face. If they're strong, you wind towards the sword, step around, and you hit them, right? Make sure you're on the other side. If you are a rapier fighter, what I recommend is you actually start in low guard and you enter with a lead edge thrust. So what I can do is I can be here and I can do this, okay? So I want the mechanical advantage. I'm not gonna thrust in knuckles down because that's too weak. It's gonna be very easy for him. So we want the lead edge coming because that gives us mechanical advantage. That forces him to really defend. And if he does, we can come around and thrust. Or if you want, you can come around and do a draw cut. What I actually like to do, if I can, is I'll come here, come around with contact, and then stick him, just to make sure I really have good coverage.
So this also is one of those things where if your opponent delivers a lazy block,
you stab him in the face.
Right, because they're losing the advantage if they just try to squat.
Yeah. Right. Would you throw a mask on real quick?
Yeah.
So, this is a little harder with the TM baton because of the bouncing one, but with metal buttons, even the synthetics, one of the reasons we cut in a fairly diagonal rather than a flat snap, go ahead and just parry, is it if just set your parry up. So, if I throw a flat snap, that's pretty easy to block. With steel or nylon, if I have a good I can actually deflect it out of the way. So that's why we want this cut. Okay? And see, that's gonna hit it, which means he has to really block. That makes that so much easier. The rule for any secondary attack is if they don't believe in the first one, none of it's gonna work. Right? The way you get your opponent to react correctly is that the first attack is real. It could even still be a fake, but if there's no reality there, then like, whatever, and then you're not going to get them. So I actually recommend the thrust area for heavy as well, because so just pull up. So the thing is that the TM bounces so much more that it's going to be hard to get something. Even if I hit him with that much junk in the way, the chance of it being a good shot or not. So I actually prefer the thrust entrance as well, because this, like, good block. So this, I still can have a lot of leverage there where you feel like you're not working in and cut around. But again, if I come in down, even if I zan to him, it's not going to have much on because he's down. So for us Batian fighters, I recommend from the low guard thrust entrance. Guys, do it with the cut if you want. It's certainly a little work less. Or you can also do the thrust and just come around. But make sure you're stacked behind it. Any questions before we use some guided practice on that one?
Yes.
Not that I've heard about it. Okay. Try to pair up with somebody that has similar tools to you, please. And very slowly, since most of us are not wearing masks.
I'm going to stand here and hold this and I'll be gay. No way. Do you know where Gabe's at?
Over there. Where?
Alright, so spread out so you have enough room. Have a designated attack defender. This is a drill. This is not sparring. One of you is going to die. You're going to be okay with that.
They're really nervous. You're so far out. All right. So start.
he's paying gate. He's paying gate. Paying the gate fee.
Good try to keep a little bit more pressure. One of your hundreds of simple, not easy. All right. So that's number one. So attacking out of distance, bringing our tools together as we attack, controlling the center line, winding if we need to, cutting around, still making sure that our center line is covered. All of that is included in that one fairly simple sequence, right? Hit them, stab them, hit them again, but a lot of the concepts are shown in them. Play number two is the same thing. So play number two is the rising. Now, the way the play is written, he just says you do some kind of winding defense, right? On the left with two tools, do the double behind. If you block this high, hit him low. Maybe not. If you are a rapier person and the other person is thrusting at you, what I want you to do is a counter thrust. So he's going to thrust at me, and I'm going to wind and counter thrust. See how I ended up there? So I would recommend being plow. When he thrusts, I'm going to wind and thrust. And then if I want to, I can boom.
When you're done,
Alright, so if you're not comfortable and you don't feel okay about the deep of the air and you're playing behind, you can just counter thrust, push, and step. You can take out the double E. Heavy, different scenario. The double E is awesome, and if I was not wearing a heavy helmet and somebody was hitting me with a baton, I would really not like to get doubled in the face. But in heavy, with a heavy helmet, it's really hard to get power to work combined with the double. So what I'm going to say is if they attack me, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do the complete roll.
That was my question. You were rolling to the flat side of the shoulder.
The reason I do the roll is because that forces my hips to turn a little bit, which gives me a good turn and snap. So I am not doing a Jupiter Aaron. I'm doing a full-on SVA heavy style back. So that's going to be very different. I still want to crack the tools. Okay. If I'm here, I still want the tie. And then everything else is really the same. The concept of it, the tool exchange, you have a high buckler and a low sword. Shows up all the time because it's a good concept. So just make sure if you're heavy, and I even like if I can to step to the outside because I need more room. So just make sure that you're boom, a little bit tighter, still with the buckler, you block high, hit them low. And that make sense?
Yeah. No, my question was when you talked before about the strength of the sword, the edge on versus the flat, when you're coming in, you're actually coming in for the block,
yep.
Flat.
Yep.
Where before you said this is the stronger.
It is, and if you block stuff,
that was my question.
So, what's interesting is if I do this very slowly with a heavy sword, I actually want to take this piece of
money,
so I actually want my original contact.
It opens!
You're making contact with
push hard, push hard. This is pretty strong. This is very pretty. So, I still want to hear what you're doing, and I'm going to roll, and I might even go, right? If they swing so hard, you're working on block, I'm going to relax. And if I go low to this side, I still want to attack. Yeah. If you might go, nothing feels dumber than dying to an O-shaped shot. I think that happens.
Just wondering about that.
So, I mean,
so it's just that roll. Yeah. You're actually making
I'm rolling
weight on.
Yep.
And then you're good.
Exactly.
Right now, I'm good.
All right. Awesome. So for us, we're just going to do this. We're still winding, still this. I'm not shoving over. I'm winding. See how my hip is also doing it? Because what I need to do is they're going to come back. So with sharp swords and no armor, this and a push and a slice is definitely going to mess up the kick. So heavy fighters will be able to have a good snap.
So point forward?
Point forward, absolutely. Yeah. Because if you can't, also if you can Alright, go ahead and try to get a new partner that has similar tools. So I like, because I fight from here a lot, I like to start from Alder most of the time. You certainly could, and a lot of people do start from like a tail guard and have a big cut up. I just like to start up here. And when I'm mixing in the bow and knee stuff, which is not going to talk about at all, I'll even start with this guard and I'll finish with this. I would say just start at Alder. Alright, please try to get with your new partner and let's do it.
I'm
Oh, Fred, that's good. Take it strong. Then I'm coming.
Lex, do you know what the charging cord looks like in the car?
I don't know.
far from sword. There you go. Come on in, please. How are we doing with that one? That would feel harder, easier, about the same?
A little more difficult, just because it's like that, your positioning is weird.
Well, part of it is the basket hilt. So when I have just a cruciform hilt sword, this is my chair. Because I'm just like, checking. Because if I just do this, it might bounce back on the finger. So this makes it, because again, all I really have to do is work out, no armor. That's a pretty bad thing. But again, if you don't want it, you can't just press. And let's go ahead and go to number four, just because we're a little short on time. I think number four is really good. So this one is, we have the initiative again. So if I'm facing Jeffy Matt, from outside, from whatever guard I want, I'm gonna throw onside, offside, high. If you're a heavy fighter, throw it out. Right? The point is we need to take this high. And I'm gonna press, now this is important, do not do this. Right? That's way too much space and time. And right? So what I'm gonna do is when I throw this high shot, I'm gonna press and slide. And I'm just gonna
cut it.
Huh? Yeah, it's like I'm slicing through his buckle like a piece of cheese. It's not really going to cut, but it keeps the pressure, because again, this is all about feeling like you need to deal with that. If I release and he feels safe, he might do something I don't like. Right? So, and when most people are on the defensive, they're kind of be like, lock, oh god, oh god! And that third one is usually the biggest one. So the pressure is important. One, two, three, boom. High buckle. Very important. Okay, so it's pretty simple. Pretty nice. Go ahead and be with a new partner if you can, somebody that has similar-ish tools. And spread out. I know this time is scary, but some of you are snuggling.
Jennifer.
Use your arm out. I wanted to go around. If I wanted to go around, I
practice as I was doing this.
Got my stick fishing around that drain. I hope he doesn't lose it. Those two? Bicycle.
So play with all the content.
Where's your classroom? There's like four or five doors there.
So what's the green one?
Okay.
One purpose.
So, again, what's cool about these is that they look great and the plays are good, but they're there to teach us lessons. So you can take these apart and put them together to point. For example, when Fergus and I were talking about it, one of the things I do in heavy is just from the low guard, rather than the 1-2-3, I will just do the high snap up instead of push. If I'm a rapier person, I might do just the high thrust setup, line down and thrust. The concept is important. I mean, practice the set plays, get the motions, and then once you feel good about them, you can start breaking them apart, and that's nice. So with play five, it's a little weird, but we can make it very simple. So play five, if you remember, is from this outside guard. I'm going to throw my wrap from outside, And if he doesn't move, right, I'm just going to try to stab over. If he does move, though, I'm going to disengage under and stab him. Right? I could just as easily, either from a plow, right, and do a passing step, or from Ulbrich with a gather step, I could just do the high thrust. I could just do the high thrust to disengage. Right? The wrap is nice because it really sells it. It's called a plunging cut. So I could just go, look at the big thing, just kidding, it's a disengage. And that's why we do it. But we could just as easily, because thrusts are scary, look at the big thrust! Right? That's fine. And having that control is good. If he pushes, this is that outside thrust. And if he keeps pushing, because nobody wants to get stabbed in the face, this is when we come back the other way, away from the back. So I'm going to recommend that everybody starts with the over thrust, because the rapid thrust is more complicated, and we're just going to run out of time. So again, start. You can start from plow and do passing over thrust, or you can start from an over or a plow and do just a gathering over thrust. The point is, we're going to over thrust and then disengage as soon as they parry. And I would recommend doing just that part a few times because the motion is silent. Right? So again, over thrust, disengage. See how I have my buckler kind of collecting high and my sword is high to try to break? Don't do anything that's going to get you stabbed. Don't do this. That doesn't work so good. So we need him, and that's why we put the sword out in front, because if he doesn't parry that, for some reason he goes, I don't respect that, you've got to do something else, right? Otherwise you're going to get stabbed in the face. Don't get stabbed in the face, right? Stab him in the face. So again, overthrust, disengage. Just practice that motion a few times. When everybody feels kind of confident, we'll talk about the next step.
All right,
so
let's
go ahead and get together and try to
overcut your
distance, please. Okay, make sure you're doing it with feet. You should not be in range before you thrust.
Very good. Do you want to stop?
So
let's
crazy
nature,
right? So where do you
Thrust.
So with your nut tie, it's going to drop over. So back, yeah, it should be a little tiny motion. So essentially, once you establish the line, I think you're attacking as soon as you see the movement. Okay. Over. Yes, good. Yep. Just practice that a few more times. That's what you want. Yep. Really quickly, take a look over here. Jeffy Matt had a good question. So come on, Alfred. So what do we do if the bad guy doesn't have paired tools to us? Right? There's lots of stuff we can do. It's fine, it doesn't work. So Jeffy Matt was asking, what if they have a shield? Because if I do an overthrust, all I'm gonna do this. Awesome. So if I'm here and I do my overthrust, that's fine. One of the things I was telling you guys, you can take the Lego pieces apart once you understand them. One thing that I do to Fred quite a bit is, remember how I was telling you that you do the line, they push over through that outside line away? I will do that against Fred's shield. I will thrust, if you're using it, I will do the outside line and stab it behind the shield that way. I actually do that a lot. And I can even do it just from range, I just do an outside line. I definitely want to do that. So the point is, though, that I'm pushing with you and I'm letting the point come in behind. I'm not trying to muscle it, and essentially from here, I'm using the edge of the shield as the lever. So you can do the whole play, even if you can do it. Right? So if you might think, oh, it's a rocket, great, up, push. And now if you were to push across, the leg's not really open, but I'm just going to pull it forward here. Because the concept is more from the team. So we want to understand what the movements are and why the movements are. Break all the rules, those who understand. That's how it always works, right? So, so against the heavy, he might come in and like, look, it's gonna be a wrap. Oh, just kidding. Oh, he lost it. I'm not a big wrap person. I don't do them very often. I'm much more likely to just do a highline thrust and then just hit. Right? Against the big right here, if you do the high thrust, right, and you know that you might not just engage, just gonna cut it, just skip that step. Yeah. Yeah. That's important. If I do this, he doesn't seem to care. I'm not going to then do this because he's not going to be reaction anymore. He's going to close me in the head. I need to feel under pressure and be defensive. So if I go do this and he's like, I don't care about that, I'm going to hit you. I have to be aware of, oh, maybe I need to block after all. Maybe I go back to you. Right? That's okay. You can ask everybody. How does someone not really want to buffer? So, from any of these, you can go into any city. For example, I attack Connor and he buries. Now, I can absolutely do play one. That's fine. Right? Go to one of the play two or three options. I could absolutely. You can mix and match as you need. The devices are there, the plays are there. And teach us good motion. And practice them for sure. But if you don't understand why you're doing this, it becomes less. And I think one of the reasons both rapiers and certainly heavy fighters struggle to implement techniques from the manual into their fighting because they don't understand the concept. They just say, well, this is the technique, and I will try to do the technique. Well, it didn't work. It must not work for my sport. That's not really the right way of looking. You know, read it and try to get that deeper understanding. What is the lesson that
it is 12:35.
Okay. Well, nobody's kicked us off late yet, but let's go ahead and do a wrap up. And then that's probably. Wait, we get till 12:45, yeah?
I don't know.
Okay, fair enough. Well, all right, I will leave it up to you guys. I haven't taught this class in this format before. Would you like another one of those things? Or would you like to kind of chat and do some problem solving questions? Okay, let's do some wrap-up. So if you are interested, I left in the handout are pretty good English translations of the German itself. So those are the players on the first page. So take a look at those. Some people interpret them a little bit differently than I do, but I did use both. I see generally in the same ballpark as them. you're already kind of prepping for that bout. What I find is that I assume that every NSCA heavy fighter is hard in the body. So what I mean by that. So the terms I'll talk quite a bit about strong and weak and forehead. So if we bind, if he is strong in the bind, me continuing to press on him gains me nothing. And I'm much more around the bind. If for some reason he is weak in the bind, then maybe I can push through and that's okay. So you have to feel if they are hard or soft in the bind. I see heavy fighters are hard in the bind, both because of the way we generate power and our tools and just the way our culture has developed. 99% of the time we are hard in the bind. So I'm almost always prepped to cut a rep. Not so much because of the bounce, but because I know that they're almost always weak and soft. A couple of times that's different, like sometimes they're close to open press, I didn't use them. That's because with the two swords, I essentially get to the bind. Exactly. But most of the time, that's why. Yes. So, for example, when we were talking about the heavy adaptation of play number two, he's in the position. I'm probably going to just I'm going to hit and release him around because that's going to be late travel for power. And because I know the chances of me just hitting the pressure, just a turnover, and then taking it are so minimal. So I will use the power to cut around. I will, however, use motion. That's why I find it easier to get soft settings from the
guys do it
because there's less bounce. And it's much
easier
to make people off of that. Motion is very strong in that posture. So if they just kind of push on it, it's fine. That's kind of where those come. So if I'm going to try and do hard fighting, I'm almost always going to do it with wrestling, and most of the time, if we're both cutting, I'm going to do a cutting wrap because it just works better.
Okay, so that's right. Okay.
Hey, get up!
Because I want my torso behind my feet. I want my center line.
I'm a little sweaty. So.
Well, I'm being careful not to ruin the picture. Yeah, not bad. Were you fighting? Just cooking.
It's an aqua.
Yes, I've heard the complaint. The wine. I'm so excited to think, come on, you're not here. You're not here.
I'm gonna get a lot hotter here in a little while. I'm gonna be out before.
Yeah.
So I'll just be right now. I don't care.
Did you
doing
the tree or did you need a
Okay.
See all the stuff over there?
Oh, okay. So you have shade. Because I brought an extra sunshade.
Yeah.
I'm just never gonna do anything with the port, so I need to say no.
It's one of those things you can't just barely do because you have to get all the tools. You can't just dabble, you have to jump right in.
I have the lapidary stuff, so. And the wheel and the weaving. Let me take care of the hobbies I have.
Yeah.
And actually, I don't have room.
My wire? Don't you lose that. That's for the forge, dude. Pick up your mess right there. Here, give me the wire. I'll pick up the mess. You want to kick?
I'm gonna say most of the time you want to wind into the sword.
We have more.
So here, so German longsword is telling you there are high winding.
Close the box, bud. Close the box. Put it in your mama's bag.
It's more about the It's position and
I think all we're doing now is talking, so I'm gonna end it.
I would be happy.